Essentially, a lot of like monosexuals, gay and straight people, take this like perverse glee in trying to tell you that you, a proud bisexual person, actually aren't bi. If they're like, when's the last time you had sex with a woman? And they try to get you in like a gotcha moment. See, you're actually just gay. I could have never fucked a woman, I'd still be bi. So, you know, like virgins who are straight, like they know they're straight, they know they're gay, it doesn't matter.
It's also fucking inappropriate. When was the last time you fucked your husband? 3 months ago? Yeah. Are you really married?
Yeah, like, really, yeah, married? Exactly.
But first, a word from our sponsors.
Celebrate mom for Mother's Day with help from Whole Foods Market. Whether you're treating her to brunch, dinner, or a nice gift, you'll find it all in one place. From May 10th through 16th, 15-stem bunches of tulips are on sale, just $9.99 for Amazon Prime members. Plus, shop 365 by Whole Foods Market for brunch staples on a budget, including smoked salmon, the mini quiche trio, and more. For dessert, pick up a heart-shaped cake from the bakery. Only the best for mom at Whole Foods Market. Terms apply.
Hey there, you look like you could use a dose of nostalgia. Well, today must be your lucky day. Step right up, because Classic Conversations sounds like the perfect podcast for you. Each week on Classic Conversations, we dive into iconic pop culture moments from the past and explore their lasting impact on the future. I, Jeff Dwoskin, your host, talks to famous people and gives you a front row seat. I talk to Sharon Gless about her iconic role as Christine Cagney on Cagney and Lacey. And in another episode, I talk to Loretta Swit, best known as Hot Lips on MASH. However, she was also the original Christine Cagney. Hear that story from both sides. Will Wheaton, Ed Asner, Cato Kaelin, Robert Klein, the original Robin, the original Flash, the original Spider-Man have all been on my show. But now I'm just bragging. You go listen to yourself. Classic Conversations. Follow us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you listen to podcasts.
Celebrate mom for Mother's Day with help from Whole Foods Market. Whether you're treating her to brunch, dinner, or a nice gift, you'll find it all in one place. From May 10th through 16th, 15-stem bunches of tulips are on sale, just $9.99 for Amazon Prime members. Plus, shop 365 by Whole Foods Market for brunch staples on a budget, including smoked salmon, the mini quiche trio, and more. For dessert, pick up a heart-shaped cake from the bakery. Only the best for mom at Whole Foods Market. Terms apply.
Welcome to the Man Whore Podcast.
Shout out to the Cougars and Cubs, the Vixens and Stags. What's up, all you boy sluts and lady johns? This is Billy Procida, and you're listening to the Man Whore Podcast. Hey, hey, welcome to my weekly endeavor to have sex-positive conversations. Been going strong for over 9 years now. This week on the pod, I'm bringing back sex expert Zachary Zane, who is going through new things. He's got new stuff he's dealing with from the last time he was on the show. I think it was like end of 2020. If you want to scroll back and hear some more of me with Zach, you can hear episode 348. Yeah, 348. He's here to promote his new book coming out, Boy Slut. But first, tickets are now on sale for the Naked Comedy Shows at Hacienda on May 20th. We got 8 o'clock and 10 o'clock shows. Ticket link is exactly where you know it is. It's at the top of the show notes. Our next Naked Comedy Shows will be June 16th. And then I've got some other totally wearing pants comedy dates, including this Saturday at Cobra Club, all there in the show notes for you. What a slutty week. It's strange. It really feels like my 20s again. I turned 30 and then the world shut down. And then I kind of, between the weed and maybe a little bit of age stuff and maybe a little bit of the breakup stuff with Wallet No Lady, my libido's been all over the place. My desire to get down and dirty, to date, to fuck, and all that has been unpredictable. I mean, I remember being 28, 29 and needing to like limit how many dates I went on in a week because I was like, oh shit, I'm not doing enough stand-up. I'm not getting enough work done because I'm always like, every night is a date night. When am I getting on stage? And I had to be like, okay, Billy, only three nights in a week can be for sex dates. Everything else has to be comedy or it's got to be daytime sex. Obviously, that has not been like needed as of late. But last week was crazy. Sex date Tuesday night, hang out with one of my regular lovers on Wednesday night. Last night, Monday night, I was with one of my long-term lovers. We had the discussion, hey, what do you want to be called? We settled on lovers, unless we're like talking to our parents, and then we can use friend. It was a dual Hacienda weekend for me. I went to two sex parties last weekend. Crazy. Thursday night, I went to Happier Hour at Hacienda, and Saturday night, I went to the masquerade party at Hacienda. Great times. Saturday night was just a constant, like, foursome roaming the party. This couple I know, and their really, really, really stupid hot friend, who for some reason seems really into me. And so, like, we just all, like, hung out and fucked and fooled around. And, like, it really was, like, a party hanging out with my friends more than it was, like, a fuck party. But hanging out with my friends tends to involve some fucking and sucking and licking some titty. Had a great time. Tried getting spanked in a stockade by this dominant NB I had met like a week prior, who just happened to be there. Ran to an ex of mine. We caught up. Things are chill. Thursday night was wild because like I ended up in this like interconnected. It was the biggest interconnected orgy of people I've been a part of. It started off with six. I mean, it started off with me on the couches by the fire pit, and like next thing I knew, these two babes were sitting on either side of me. The same women I was hanging out with on Saturday night with one of their husbands. Next thing we know, we're like walking around. We connect with these two dudes who they have played with before, who I know from, you know, being around the scene for a while. So we're all talking and the five of us are like, we should get a room. So we're waiting for one of the rooms to open up. And then we like kind of pick up this other chick who I've never met before, but she's played with the other two guys. So the six of us eventually are working our way into the mirror room. And I have to like stop for a moment and be like, to this sixth person, to this lady, and just be like, oh, hi, my name is Billy. I guess we should know each other's names because we're about to be in an orgy puddle together for the next 2 hours. And she's like, oh, yeah, hi, my name is blank. And then, like, you know, next thing I know, like, my tongue is in her mouth and someone's grabbing my dick and she's grabbing some other dude's dick and someone else is, like, feeling her pussy. It was cool, man. It was like, I'm looking up at the, because there's a mirror on the ceiling of this bedroom, and we kept looking up, and every time you'd look up, it was like another snapshot of a super hot, like pornographic scene. Plus there's a lot of laughter going on. Funniest orgy I've ever been in. Everyone had a lot of people had good punchlines here and there. Hard to keep a boner through it, but like it was fun. I'm making out and fooling around with these like three beautiful women for like a couple hours, and I mean, it's a blast. And if, I don't know, if either of those are listening, like, hi, hey, great, would repeat, would still repeat. But all the orgies, all the fuck dates, all the swallowing squirt cum, all the brand new exciting connection of that, like, first time you make out with someone and, like, they're a good kisser and you're, like, sick. And I had to push this thought out of my head as we were getting onto the bed, but I couldn't help but think, yeah, I'd give this up for Wallet No Lady. Like, this is fun. This is hot. I'm glad I get to be a part of this. I would like to keep being a part of this if that's the case. But even going home, I just thought, wish I could go back in time and whisper in my, you know, old self's ear during one of several conversations where non-monogamy's coming up and she's proposing what type of thing non-monogamy to do. And I'm pushing back because I'm scared of something different and new and potentially restrictive. But, you know, I was operating from such a place of fear. I was blinded to the fact of like, but which do I want more? Yeah, I want both. But grow the fuck up, Billy. Which do you want more? And it's just so obvious and clear to me. And I don't know how I could have missed it then. I wish I could like lean to my ear and be like, it's okay. It's okay to agree to this. It's okay to give this a try. You're not going to lose some sort of slut credentials. You're not going to lose your identity because you, try swinging or even do a period of monogamy, whatever. I wish I could just go right now to Alligator Lounge and whisper in my ear, it's okay. Realized a little too late that I know which I choose. And I know that information far too late. I mean, I guess we're going back to the origins of the show. If you're newer to the program, you may not know this about me, but I think, you know, this kind of comes back to, it's great getting laid. I'm happy that's a thing that I'm able to do without having abs or a monster dick or a ton of money, but I want love. I had, like, I think the ultimate secret boss level version of love. I may or may not experience that again. And though sex is fun, I would choose that. It's not what I think everyone should choose. I don't think it's categorically better for everybody. It's just for me, that's what I want. So I still feel, you know, I've said it before, I feel bad for these incel guys sometimes, and or dudes who are seem to wallow in not knowing how to talk to women or not getting girls or not getting laid, and they're going the pickup artistry or red pills. And it's like, because I think they think that the sex is going to make them happy and that's going to fill something inside of them. But roughly 30 to 180 minutes after they come, it's still there. Sex isn't going to solve it. It does make some of the loneliness more bearable. And I'm also very fortunate that I'm not like lonely. You know, it's the regular lovers in my life. I've got some people who not only like fucking me, but they also care about me. And they're there for me, and they want to celebrate my wins, and they offer support when I need it. And they let me support them when they need it. But there's something about it that's still not the same. It's there's a romantic element, this intangible, I don't know what. I had it. Again, back to origin of this podcast. Women will sleep with me, but they won't date me. And now it still is. Women will sleep with me, but deep love, that one's hard to keep a hold of. Just as it was when I was 24, when some of y'all virtually met me at 33, that's still the thing I would want. Anyways, I guess I bring some of that up because it comes up during my conversation with Zachary Zane today, where we do talk about being in relationships where it's not on a relationship escalator and it's not going towards X, Y, or Z. Being in relationships where you care about people, but it's just not romantic. It's not that love thing, you know? Or it's not that romantic love. Because I do love and care about, my close partners, lovers, companions, if I'm speaking to an aunt. And I thought it was interesting to connect with Zachary on that aspect. But hey, in the meantime, we coming. When I left Happier Hour on Thursday night, I was getting dressed, and there's this dude also getting dressed in the basement. He was just being like, he had seen me in the orgy pile for like 2 hours with these babes. And he was like, yo, Billy, you the man, dude. You just, wow, I saw that and you were with these chicks and whoa. And you seem to have two women on your arm all night. And I'm like, yeah, it's pretty cool. But yeah, you ever just unconditionally hold space in the center of your chest where you hold the thoughts and ideas of a future together? That's the tits. And I say that as a guy who's had a lot of tits in his mouth over the past 8 days. Before we get to my guest this week, Zachary Zane, let's do a quick fan whore appreciation moment. Here's a quick one, everybody. I want to give a shout out. I want to give a thank you right now to Kay, who turns out to be Gabe Malika's sister. I don't know if y'all remember a few weeks ago, I had on comedian Gabe Malika, and we did a bonus episode. It's all about Gabe's like summer of love, but we called it like the summer of Gabe. And I don't know, I guess his sister heard the episode and was like, what's this summer of my brother thing about? Because she put down $5 and then 45 minutes later, unpledged. And I'm like, I think she just wanted to hear the bonus episode. So I thank you, Kay, for your contribution, even if ever so brief. I got a question for you. You listening, yes, you right now, you who have listened to at least 10 episodes of this podcast and you like it. You like it enough, you check in to see what the title is every week. Maybe you're hanging out a lot in the Champagne Room, our Discord server. And you've never joined my Patreon. Just real quick, I'm not guilting you. I'm going to frame it in this way. If we were at a bar, okay, or if we were at a coffee shop together, would you get me a drink? Would you be like, oh, Bill, oh, are you Billy? Hey, man, I love the podcast. Can I get you a tea? Can I get you a beer? If you would, how about instead, at least for now, while we are not geographically in the same places, how about for now, you become a member of my Patreon community and support my ability to get my own tea, to get my own drink, or even buy a beer for a pretty lady. Sometimes I think people go, oh, I don't want to give to this or I don't want that to get a cut. And, you know, I'll just support them in the unlikely event that we see each other in person. I'll offer to buy them a burger. It's like I could use the burger money now, though. Become a member today. Support the pod you love. Virtually buy me a drink for now. Or even if you're at the $2 tier, like think of it as like you just got me some tea. A nice jasmine tea. No honey needed. It's okay. And I'll take it in a mug because there will be refills. Become a member today. Support the pod you love at patreon.com/manwhorepodcast or download the Patreon app. You can find me on there. Links, by the way, always in the show notes. And now for this week's guest, Zachary Zane. Again, you heard him way, way back when on episode 348. What you need to know about Zachary is he is a sex expert. He is a writer for a variety of publications. His entire brand is that he is bi. No, but seriously, I've never seen someone rock being bi as a brand harder than Zachary Zane. He's quite good at it. And he's like very resentfully attractive, which I think I kind of dig at him at various times in the episode because there's nothing, as someone like me, a real solid 7.5, it's really nice to make a 10 feel bad about being a 10. It's not gaslighting a 10 into thinking they're not a 10. We're not negging. We're just like, we are aggressively acknowledging their 10-ness and then making them go home and journal like, what did I do in life to deserve being such a dime? I don't know. But it seems to be that Zachary wields his dimeness, his 10, his double digit with responsibility in this world, spreading knowledge and orgasms all over New York City. And he's got a new book. It's coming out. It's still available for pre-order, which, as you'll hear in his plugs, pre-orders, they're super important. There's a link in the show notes so you can pre-order it through my indiebookshops.org spot. So not only will you be pre-ordering Zachary Zane's book, you will be pre-ordering it through an independent bookstore instead of that guy named Bezos or the noblest of Barnes. And when you shop through my bookshops.org link, Billy the Kid over here gets a little cut on the back end. Okay, so you're supporting three indienesses in one. And there'll be a link in the show notes for that. Anyways, enough of my whatever this is. If you're new to the podcast, by the way, not all the intros are this long. Some definitely are, but I don't think they all are. let's go chat with Zachary Zane.
Is the stress of all this promo stuff like eking into any of your relationships? You getting a little snappy at anyone?
No, I haven't been. And I think they know that like this is my priority at the moment. My partners are aware that like they are just not my huge priority at this moment. Like this is something I've been working on for nearly 5 years. It's coming out. These months leading up to it are huge in terms of getting press and doing influencer campaigns and interviews and giveaways, podcasts, everything. And this is just going to be my priority. So we might not be getting dinners the same way we used to because I'm working later. And again, I'm not they know this. Like it's not something where it comes as a surprise to them. They're aware that like, hey, just for these 2 months, my focus is on work. And so this is what it's going to have to be. And they're completely okay with that.
I'm like shocked when they are. Cause like I have this whole people pleasing thing where I go like, I feel like I'm disappointing everyone by taking care of me. And they're like, no, you can take care of you.
Yeah. And it's not like, of course, things have come up with my partner, with my girlfriend, where like she had a I don't want to share her business, but, you know, I had a really rough few things happen. And of course, I did drop what I was doing and I did cancel what I was doing. But that was an extenuating circumstance. It's not like every day I'm going to have to drop and move things around. So, yeah, I don't want to make it seem like, oh, it's just about me and go fuck yourself. Like, of course, I'll be there if you really need me. But like for now, I just need to focus on my book.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Good for you for being able to.
Yeah.
I try to fucking focus on my work and go like, yeah, but is everyone going to leave me because I didn't see them for, you know, 9 days.
Yeah.
They're like, it's fine. But I think that's a good sign of that's a sign of a good partner. If they can say, I get it. You're good. I'm still going to be here.
Yeah.
On the other end of this.
Yeah. You know?
Exactly. And so you just have right now, what's your situation? You just got the one girlfriend? I tried to ask Melissa, but she's like, you know what, dude? I have no idea. We get a newsletter and then that's about
it. It's, I don't want to say they come and go. That's not, makes it sound like I'm using people or going through people. But right now I just have kind of one girlfriend and then a bunch of, the word partner is always a little bit complicated where it's like, friends who I fuck, like some of them kind of prefer the word partners, some preferred friends, some prefer hookups, some prefer to say we're seeing each other, right? There's no universal definition of what partner means. So, and especially when you're polyamorous, it gets a little bit more complicated. When you fuck your friends, it gets a little bit more complicated. So, I do have a girlfriend and then just secondary partners, people I fuck, friends, people in my life where we have, you know, a sexual relationship along with a friendship.
Do you ever have to have like, I've had to have this conversation recently with some people as I'm not like romantically available, but I'm emotionally available. I like to like the people I hook up with. And so I've had to have a couple conversations of like, what do you want me to call you? And has that ever gotten tense?
It's, yeah, I think in the past that it has gotten tense. I think I've gotten a lot better about managing expectations kind of from the beginning. Honestly, erring on the side of like saying things too soon as opposed to too late in terms of what I'm looking for in a partner, what I can give in a partner. For example, my girlfriend now, we had a talk and then we said like, I as we started dating, I was like, I don't see this being my long-term relationship. I don't see you as being my wife. I don't
the
see
woman I just met.
Yeah.
Okay.
Of moving in together. I actually think for my queer identity, it's very important for me to be, for my primary partner to be a man.
Yeah.
I think it's really important. You know, I like going to gay clubs and I don't want to feel like I'm a visitor in my own home. And even when we go to a gay club, it's like I fucked more men than all the guys in there. She's fucked more women than all the lesbians in there. And still, you know, if we were intimate with each other or kiss each other, we get these nasty looks.
It wipes away both of your queerness.
It does. And
even
like,
though y'all have the numbers to back
yeah,
up everything.
Yeah. Not,
like,
not,
I own
not,
this fucking place.
Yeah. Not even that like fucking numbers, you know, validate your queer identity. But still, it's just like, I want to be able to go into certain spaces and feel not like a visitor there. And yeah, so I think it's really important for my queer identity to be with a man long term. And for that person to end up being my husband. So I said this very early on. I said this because I like you. I like spending time with you. But I've run into issues in the past where like any type of almost like kind gesture is somehow thought of as being part of a relationship escalator. So it's like if I get you flowers or something like, oh, Zach wants it to be more serious. I take you out for a nice birthday dinner because it's your birthday dinner. They kind of, instead of it being like, oh, this is just a nice thing for someone I'm dating. It's very much like, oh, this person really wants to be with me forever or really loves me. And even when I say I love you, when I say that, that doesn't mean I want to marry you. It doesn't mean that I want to be with you forever. It just means that I love you. And I do. And I love a lot of people. And so, yeah, I've just run into issues in the past where my behavior, even when I kind of specify in the beginning, hey, I don't see this as being a primary partnership. Like, especially when I was like more solo poly and I was like, okay, I'm really only looking for secondary partners. I'm focusing on my book. I'm focusing on myself. Is this okay? A little bit down the line, we end up at this junction where it's like, they're like, okay, well, I want to be your girlfriend. I love you. I want to be with you forever. And it's like, no, well, fuck, no. I kind of said this from the beginning.
Is love on the table, just not the relationship escalator part?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I do love these people. And I just, you know, most relationships you break up. That's just the truth of it. You know what I mean? But it's just been frustrating in the past where I feel like I'm very clear about my intentions. Everyone seems to be on board. But then if I do nice or cutesy things, people get very excited and want more from me. So that's
and then
why
sometimes you're just like, should I just not do the cutesy thing that I otherwise want to do?
Yeah, which is I have some
or do I have to do it with all this apology like wrapped around it?
It's I have some guy friends who have literally told me, do not fucking do cutesy things until you like them, until you know you want to be with them and you want this person to really be your girlfriend. I'm like, that's so fucked up.
Yeah.
That's so withholding. And their reasoning was because you end up in the situations that you're in. Zach, you asked me how to not end up in the situation that you're in. I'm giving you the advice and you're telling me it's fucked up. I'm like, 'cause it is fucked up, but I also actually see where you're coming from. And that probably leads there to be less confusion.
But does that mean that, wait a second, rare returning guest to the podcast, Zachary Zane, the sex expert, asks his dumb buddies for advice?
Of course. Of course. I think everyone always assumes.
Welcome back.
Yeah, thank you. I think people always assume when you're a sex expert, you have everything figured out. But of course, obviously, therapists have therapists. And it's also much easier to deal with someone else's problems than to deal with your own problems. I think I'm much more self-aware than most people. I know where I struggle and where I need to work on. I'm not necessarily delusional the way I have certain friends who seemingly don't take any responsibility for anything they've ever done in every relationship. It's always their ex is an asshole. They were an asshole. He was an asshole. She was an asshole. She was a bitch. He was an asshole. It's like, well, you know, if you think everyone's an asshole, you're the fucking asshole.
And what I do is I just start with, I am an asshole. And then here's all this other stuff.
It's, yeah.
I like to 8 Mile myself every day.
Yeah, no, but I absolutely ask my friends who know my specific bullshit and give me good advice. You know what I mean? And that's also one of the things where your friends know you best. I think it's really good to ask for relationship advice if you can handle what they're going to say. Like if you have that kind of friend dynamic where it's like you can punch someone in the face and your best friend's going to be like, yes, that guy fucking deserved it. Kill him. You're like, I actually murdered his whole family too. Oh my God, they sucked. Where do you want me to bury the body? Like you have to have friends who are going to honestly and authentically tell you like, hey, this is something, a pattern I've seen that you do in your relationships and might be something mindful of, and you not responding with anger or shame or being defensive or projecting your own insecurities. So if you can actually listen to your friend's advice, then it's worth reaching out to them.
Even your, dare I say, your straight buddy guys.
They offer like
do they ever give you advice and you're like, okay, I hear what you're trying to say, but it's got all this other stuff we got to deconstruct.
My straight buddy friends still suck dick, so I don't know how straight my straight guy friends are at this point, but it's always good to just get different perspectives, you know, from someone straight, someone who's a man, woman, non-binary, gay, straight, bisexual. Everyone has different experiences, and I always crowdsource my relationship problems, and it actually really helps me.
Okay.
Yeah.
What was a recent time that was difficult receiving that advice?
Again, that wasn't as difficult as much, like I wasn't mad. What am I trying to say? It wasn't difficult as much as I disagreed, but it's not even that I disagreed. It was more like I was just frustrated by like, fuck, is this the world we live in where like people are so desperate for love and romance that like they grasp onto it like a sinking fucking ship, or someone gives them a morsel of kindness and a kind gesture. I think it shows how fucking low the bar is set and how just shitty so many guys and women, but I think now I'm mainly I think for what I'm specifically discussing, I think it is more of a guy issue than a woman issue, not to gender things.
It's a bar we trip over. I think women can walk into the bar a little bit,
but it's just like, yeah, I think guys have been so withholding of affection and love that when people get it, they just get so excited by it and see it as a scarce commodity that they need to hold on to and keep at all costs because they're not sure when they're going to get it again. Mm-hmm. And that is fucking sad.
Pressure. Yeah. If we are the type who are able to have, like, to be emotionally available and we're able to do like romantic gestures that maybe aren't part of this one. We need to not have the relationship escalator. Can we normalize that relationship thing at the airport where you stand on?
I love that. The relationship just move.
The idea of it being a scarce commodity came up recently because I felt so somebody, she like asked, she's like, hey, like maybe I could come over tonight and cuddle. And I had been asking for like, I want to go out and like have fun. That's how we met. We met like had like an accidental like 5 a.m. night. I want to do more of that. And so I was like, oh, you're not giving me what I'm asking for, but you want to get this resource, this the affection and the care, something I've typically tend to be kind of good at. And so I've almost started feeling guarded of like my care and affection.
Yeah. And I feel like that can be a tough relationship to have, where someone's like, okay, you just lean on me for emotional support and I'm your partner because I'm a good listener and I'm there when you call me and you're good at cuddling or whatever it is. But then I have my party friends, then I have my partner that I go out with. And when you're that emotional support, either partner or friend, either way, it doesn't matter if it's romantic or platonic, you can't help but feel like, fuck, like, you only use me for this. And like, again, I'm happy to be there for you, but I also have my needs, and my needs are less emotionally supporting you. My needs are like going out and having fun, which is one thing that I've wanted to do with you. So just making sure, if you're leaning on someone for emotional support, which obviously you are allowed to do, that's not the only reason you're talking to them or using, again, that is using them.
And knowing that like men in like capital M men are not giving that support and given that those like, we'll call it a kind of a resource very often, that the bar is low and all, like we know that. And so, like I said, it's like, I've almost been like, shit, should I be like guarding this the way like some women guard pussy?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They're like, well, I know this is like a treasured resource, so I should be careful.
In general, I'm never a fan of guarding anything, you know, and that's why I try to have these conversations early and often. Often if it's becoming an issue again, but like for something like this, like essentially, and this is, you know, writing the sex and relationship advice column at Men's Health, often I get very articulate, smart kind of questions about like, this is what I'm feeling and I'm not sure what to do. And often my response is, tell them exactly what you told me, like verbatim, like you're allowed to have these feelings. You're allowed, like, and you know, when you don't express them or you feel like you're getting taken advantage of, you become resentful, more problems arise. But in this situation, instead of being guarded, it's being like, hey, I want to be there for you. I want to support you. I want to be emotionally available for you. However, sometimes I feel like that's the only thing I am to you and this person that I am in your life. And I don't want to be just that. I want us to be able to have a fun relationship where we get to go out together and party together and have some of my needs also getting met beyond providing you, you know, emotional support when you need to, which again, I'm happy to do. I want to be there for you, but I also want our relationship to be more than that.
Sure.
I mean, that was off the cuff, so reframe it. But something like all of this stuff is like, everyone always says communication, and it's exhausting. And it's not just communicating, it's how you communicated it. I think the way I said that was very much like, I feel I'm happy to be there for you, but can we actually do more? As opposed to being like, you're taking advantage of me, you're manipulative, you're only using me for emotional support, and then you go out with your other guy friends and party and fuck them, and why the fuck am I this dude? Again, you're conveying the same thing in both of those things. One's more likely to get a more positive response. So it's always how you communicate your needs. And again, she might not even be aware that she's doing this. You know what I mean? Like,
it's so interesting right now we're watching you jump so into like advice columnist mode.
Yeah.
Like you're writing a draft right now. I can watch you doing it.
You see when my eyes start rolling to the back of my head, that's how you know I'm really thinking here. But like, again, going into this with intent that I don't think she's being malicious. She might not even be aware that she's doing this or being purposely manipulative.
Yeah, and we had a good convo. We followed up. We had discussion. So just
talking about it.
We figured that, you know, that out, but just the idea of, you know, the bar being like us knowing the context of dating for, say, women, then it's like we almost interpret some stuff through all that context to be like, oh, well, I know like they're latching on to this because I know this does not get offered very often in their like dating pools. And then it's like now that's informing how I do the thing in the first place.
And it shows when people really fall in love with you way too quickly in a way where I'm like, you actually don't know me yet, like, well enough to cut. Like, again, we get excited.
You're just thrilled someone's treating you nicely.
Yeah,
sometimes.
Which, again, is just fucking sad that this is the kind of the state of the world we live in. And of course, right now I'm talking in generalizations. I'm talking in more gendered terms. Obviously, this is not all men. This is not all women. This is not straight, gay, whatever it is. But I think it would be naive of me to not say that this is a trend that is something that is happening, and at least something that's really happening to the two of us. You know, this is other people struggle with different issues. This is something that I have been struggling with. This is my main struggle I have with relationships. That, again, I've been working on and talking to my douchebag friends about and getting their advice. So it's great.
So, you know, it's interesting when you said that, like, you know, for the sense of your identity, like, you would want a long-term partner who's a man.
Yeah.
Is interesting. And so correct me if I maybe misunderstood a long time ago, but when we spoke, you know, back in like late 2020, when you on, I think my interpretation of you at the time was like, okay, you know, his brand is bi. And then like, I just assumed like you leaned, if not at least 50-50 towards men. And then you were like, actually, I hook up with women more than I do with men. And I was like, what?
It's boom. I still do. And this realization of wanting eventually my primary partner to be a man has been a new one.
Okay.
That hasn't always been the case. Right now, I still have more sex with women than I do men, and I still date more women than I do men. I have my girlfriend, and mm-hmm. I love her, and everything is great with us. But especially the reason why I'm dating more women, or dating and hooking up with more women than men at the moment, is kind of twofold. The first one is
we've seen a picture of you. That's number one. I get it.
That helps. But it's, I really have found in the past couple of years, like, a bisexual, polyamorous, sex positive community. And like places like Hacienda, where I just saw you there, whatever it was, 2 weekends ago.
Yeah.
And in those places, even though they are very queer friendly, it is women still predominantly date men, and women date and hook up with women, but there are very few, even if there are bi guys there, they're kind of new to their sexuality. Maybe they hook up with dudes, but they don't have boyfriends.
You don't see a lot of male-male couples at those parties.
You really don't. And so while maybe they will have a threesome and suck someone's dick, like, they're not actually looking for a romantic relationship with another man. And because I tend to meet people out as opposed to on apps, and it's not because I am cool or whatever, but it's just like, given what I do, like, I'm kind of on paper potentially a tough sell, where it's just like, it's like, he's this wild sexual, bisexual, polyamorous dude. And like, so a lot of like, you want to date people in the community, in the scene, who understand that, who aren't judging you, who don't treat you like a fucking lion behind a cage.
You can jump in. You don't have to do 3 dates of explaining stuff. Yeah. You can just already jump in running.
So because of that, I prefer to meet people IRL, and because I'm just in spaces where essentially the options to date are predominantly, and have sex are predominantly women. That's what it is. And I went to a gay bar recently, and I just kind of struggled being there. I hadn't been there in a long time. And it was like a Hell's Kitchen gay bar.
Okay.
But, you know, you walk in, everyone is kind of sizing you, looking at you up and down. I was flirting with this dude, and then a hotter dude walked by. And I swear to God, after 5 minutes of us talking, he just like, hey, and just like, just stop talking to me to start flirting with this other dude. I was like, are you serious? Like not even like,
do you know who I am?
But no, it wasn't even a no, but like, just like the common, like, to not even be like, hey, hold on, I'm going to go grab a drink, or I'm going to excuse myself and then go and talk to this other dude. But to like, literally like, stop, stare midway through conversation, just, and then just start talking to the other dude and completely ignoring me. I'm like, wow, like, I'm a pretty confident dude in terms of sexually, romantically, and how I am. And I realize I just feel often insecure in these gay spaces. And again, that's a Hell's Kitchen gay space. There are gay spaces in Brooklyn that are queer.
Do you want to like kind of define, what does that mean, a Hell's Kitchen gay space?
It's like Hell's Kitchen in WeHo, West Hollywood. I feel like there's a common gripe where you end up with this like very, and again, it is a stereotype, but a stereotype that's based off of reality, you know, in many of these spaces where it's just like this kind of like very traditionally attractive, good looking, jacked dude. And they only talk to other jacked guys. And they are like,
they bench press each other.
They bench and press then they each fuck. Other. They can be very just mean and catty and not welcoming and very, you know, potentially racist or sizist or femphobic. And it's like, they just want other guys who are exact molds of them. Mm-hmm. At which point I'm like, why do you even go out? Just hang out with your guy if you're not looking to meet new people. But just like, there is often a vibe and a bitchiness and a like, oh, who are you to even be talking to me? Do you see how I look? Do you see how you look? And you're like, ugh, this is like, this is how we treat each other?
How's that different from like, say, the West Village?
But, I mean, West Village is different. West Village is, A, has more women there. I feel like it's more touristy. And they're also like older establishments in West Village where you just have like older gays there.
Yeah.
And again, this is not every gay club. I like going out to, again, more gay or queer spaces in Brooklyn that is more inclusive of women, and the guys there are still gay and bi, and they're people of all races, all body types, all expressions of gender. And it's much more, I feel like,
what's a bar like that, you say, if you wanted to like kind of compare and contrast
a bar like that? Honestly, I haven't.
It's like a Pieces, like something you're describing?
No, because Pieces is Chelsea still. Like, they're again, these are like, it's, I don't want to say like the underground Brooklyn queer scene, but it kind of is. There is that type of thing here, and often it's a lot more, I'm trying to think, a lot more like party based, where people will throw, I think Baby's All Right has like good parties like this, Mood Ring has kind of good things again, but the truth of the matter is I've been going out of those spaces, so I'm actually out of the loop. I've been going to these, again, these bi poly sex positive spaces, which also I love because then you can also fuck people there, like, awesome, and get naked in a jacuzzi and go nuts. But I've definitely, yeah, like, a very long answer to why I end up dating and having sex with more women than men.
Because it seems like it's easier.
Well, it's not easier. It's, I'm just in those spaces. Like, if I want to fuck a dude, I could do it in 4 seconds. I live next to Prospect Park. I could literally go cruising the park and be raw-dogging a dude within a minute and a half. Like, there are apps. There's Grindr. There is Sniffies. I can go to a gay bar, get picked up. It's not a matter of ease. It's a matter of, do not enjoy those spaces as much as I enjoy these now new sex positive queer poly spaces. And so I'm putting myself in the spaces that I enjoy, and therefore, and this happens to be the clientele, so I'm meeting that those people.
Anything in particular, was there some sort of pivotal moment like that sparked all of a sudden like, I think I want to long-term be with a man?
Yeah, I think it was actually in dating a woman, and where things were kind of very quickly, it was clear she kind of wanted more of like a traditional relationship in terms of getting married and having kids. And I was like, well, I definitely don't want to have kids. And that I know, and I'm going in to get my vasectomy, which is exciting. But it just made me kind of question and think, being like, God, like Zach and like living in the suburbs with kids and a wife, like I like my queer identity, and I don't want that ever to be ripped away from me, and I want to always be perceived as queer. That's important to me, and I feel like I just am losing this part of me when I end up dating a woman. And it's sad because it's not, it's because of the world that we live in. If things were different and the world wasn't as divided into gay and straight, I wouldn't have to pick gay or straight. But because
the suburbs seem straight to you.
Yes. But like, when the world is, and I can't be perceived as being visibly bisexual, I wish I could. And that's the thing about bisexuality. Visibility is quite challenging when you're bi.
No matter how much you say, boy slut, boy slut, boy slut, get the book, boy slut. I'm boy slut. They're like, but like, are you?
But are you? But it's just like, you know, there are very easy kind of depictions of like gay culture, and also like if you're a man in a relationship with a man, you're perceived as gay. Unless if you have a man and a woman on your arm simultaneously and you're in a mixed gender polyamorous throuple, people are going to assume that you are straight or gay. And yeah, so that's why visibility kind of becomes an issue. You can't be visibly bisexual in many ways, and I wish we could. So when that's the case, I still want to be queer, and and it's important, again, for my identity, for that to be the case. I don't want to be in a traditionally gendered relationship where I'm the guy in the relationship and she's the woman in the relationship. And even when we try to be more egalitarian, even when I'm dating bi women and more masculine women and poly women, we still end up falling into these gendered dynamics, even when we try not to, because it's just so fucking ingrained in us and society reinforces it. And I don't want that. I want a more egalitarian relationship. I want us to not have be like, I'm the man, she's the woman. And when you're dating another man, you don't run into that issue because we're both the fucking men. You know what I mean?
But if you walked in that gay bar alone, do they, like, they assume otherwise?
No, they assume I'm gay. I mean, I read as gay. I have a gay voice. I also usually dress. If I'm going to a gay club, I'm not wearing, you know, jeans and a t-shirt. Or even if I'm wearing jeans and a t-shirt, I'm wearing tight ass jeans.
I'm always lounged out on the couch if there is one.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I love how I really.
Well, earlier you were doing your thing because like you sat on my couch like 2 years ago the exact same way.
Really?
You were just legs propped up. I am comfortable.
I love this is how I end up like doing voice notes and writing half the time. It's just either lounging or pacing. Those are my two.
Sure.
My two.
You're very fun to observe.
Thank you.
Warning, the following podcast has been rated XBL for extreme blasphemy.
Hi, human. Welcome to the God Pod. I'm God, and like Jesus, I'm hanging in there.
Hey!
Calm down, Jesus.
If you like interviews with the most interesting people alive or dead, then you'll love the God Pod.
Here's me talking to Mary Trump about her crazy uncle.
I knew he was going to be disastrous. I knew he was going to be cruel.
And here's me debating a real live atheist.
You really cannot make the case that this is a good book.
I've interviewed comedians, authors, scientists. I discuss all the latest current events down on Earth with my co-hosts, Jesus, Mary Magdalene, Satan, and more.
When it comes to the case of Jesus, Satan, you are not the father.
Woo! Oh, yeah! You can't go wrong with adding the God Pod to your rotation. It's incredibly funny, and there's never a dull show.
Damn right!
Find the God Pod wherever you get podcasts.
The God Pod. Have it, Yahweh.
Hey everyone, I'm Sean.
And I'm Joe.
And we are the hosts of The Horror Show, the show that dissects, mutilates, dismembers, and butchers all of your favorite and not so favorite cult classics and horror movies. We're talking about everything from Lori Loughlin dancing on a BMX bike in Rad, all the way over to 80s classics like Friday the 13th and Nightmare on Elm Street.
Join us every week as we pick another movie that we try desperately to find the good in while laughing our way through the bad.
And there's a lot of bad. Looking through his movies, he appears to just love frogs, because then we get Toad Warrior in 1996 and Max Hell Frog Warrior in 2002. So,
not a fan of horror? Don't worry about it. Almost every episode is filled with personal anecdotes and jokes about all things entertainment.
So join us every week on any of your favorite podcasting apps and services, or find us at IHateHorror.com or on Instagram at IHateHorror.
Have you ever wondered why we call French fries French fries? Or why something is the greatest thing since sliced bread? There are answers to those questions. Everything Everywhere Daily is a podcast for curious people who want to learn more about the world around them. Every day, you'll learn something new about things you never knew you didn't know. Subjects include history, science, geography, mathematics, and culture. If you're a curious person and want to learn more about the world you live in, just subscribe to Everything Everywhere Daily, wherever you cast your pod.
You know, so I mentioned earlier, you know, I have in my Discord server, the Champagne Room, everyone, link in the show notes. We have an Ask the Guest channel for all of my Patreon members. You can ask any question you want. I'll ask it. If it's a bad question, wasn't mine. If it's a good question, I wish it was. And you actually have gotten the most questions anyone has since I started doing this.
Really? Many months ago. I feel honored.
Many questions.
Oh, God.
Some of it's just like Julia said, not even a question. Please tell him that I fangirl over his newsletter every time it comes in my inbox. Like,
His name Julian, you said?
Her name is Julia. She's
Julia. Yeah. Tell Julia I love her. And yeah, thank you. That's awesome.
You know, and some of these are touching on what we're talking about. So how about we got, you know, Vince asked, he was the one who I told you was just like, before he even started asking questions, just like went on and on about like, I fucking love this dude. This dude's like my fucking idol. This guy's this. I know I'm comfortable as a bi guy because this guy, all that jazz, right?
Thank you. My head's going to explode. My ego's going to get too big.
I know. It's dangerous.
It's
right?
Dangerous.
But he, one of the questions he had was, when you come across the misconceptions about bi men being slutty, you know, in everyday conversation or on a date, how do you decide when to stop and educate someone and when to let things slide?
I have an incredible fucking chapter about this in my book, Boy Slut, yeah. A Memoir and Manifesto, coming out on May 9th of this year, anywhere books are sold. So I have a chapter called, and it's in quotes, "So How Do You Know You're Bi?" And it was specifically, and it's actually a divergence from the rest of the chapters, which are more memoir-y, where I actually go through the list of like 30 questions people have asked me when I've told them I'm bisexual, and some of them are extremely invasive, ignorant, aggressive. Some are well-intended. Some are people who clearly are struggling with their own sexuality, so they want to learn more. And the way I break it down is, here's how I have replied, and here's how I wish I have replied. But in this chapter, there are a few things I address in terms of, for example, sluttiness is interesting, because that's a stereotype where stereotypes in general are bad. Don't overgeneralize a group. However, there's stereotypes about bisexuality that are not inherently bad. For example, there's nothing wrong with being slutty, versus the idea that bisexual people are cheaters or liars or dishonest. That's actually a negative stereotype, because cheating, lying, and dishonest is not good by any metric, versus there's nothing wrong with being slutty. So I do like to make a differentiation between stereotypes that are actually bad and ones that are just like, okay, this is a generalization. There are bi people who are slutty and there are ones who are not. And I am one that obviously is slutty. And I know for a while, there was this fear with bisexual visibility that we couldn't be, like, we kind of removed sex from it. Like
the gays were doing, like, in the 70s or whenever, exactly. When they were like, let's just show everyone, no, we just want to hold hands and get married.
That's literally exactly what it was. And I've been someone who pushes up against that, where I'm like, no, sex is a large part of bisexuality. And I think doing this neutered version of ourselves to make ourselves more palatable is actually going to be detrimental long term. So I think we should embrace being slutty and loving threesomes, and instead of being like, we're not slutty, being like, well, some of us are, what's wrong with that? Don't stereotype or overgeneralize. But to answer the last part of his question, it took me a long time to figure out when to respond and when not to respond when people were attacking my bisexuality. And I used to often kind of play it like, if they're like, when's the last time you had sex with a woman? And the reason why they're asking that question is, essentially, a lot of like monosexuals, gay and straight people, take this like perverse glee in trying to tell you that you, a proud bisexual person, actually aren't bi. And they try to get you in like a gotcha moment. See, you're actually just gay. And so that was, they're trying to get me this gotcha moment. And I used to like tell them everyone I had fucked, and that all the women I'd fucked. But that's also playing into a trope that I don't want to, like, because I could have never fucked a woman, I'd still be bi. Like, there's, you know, like virgins who are straight, like they know they're straight, they know they're gay. It doesn't matter if you're monogamous with someone and you want to be monogamous and you've never had sex with a woman because of that, you're still bi. You've just chosen this committed relationship.
It's also fucking inappropriate.
Also,
it's just like, okay, can I grow you on your anal?
I know.
When's the last time you fucked your husband? 3 months ago? Yeah. Are you really married?
Married? Exactly. So I used to kind of engage and answer in a way that I no longer do. And the way I decide whether to answer and like engage or not is if I actually think it's someone that is genuinely, I think intent actually goes a long way. If someone is genuinely curious or doesn't understand, and there's an opportunity that in talking to them, they might actually grow and change their mind and learn something, I'm more inclined to have this conversation with them. If they're looking for an argument, what's actually better than a well-executed like defense is being like, I'm not going to answer that. I know I'm bisexual and I don't really care if you believe it or not. Like the moment, and I've said that to people, when people try to question or justify, how do you know you're really bisexual? No, I know. And you just see how uncomfortable and awkward they get when you kind of show them like, I don't need to prove my sexuality or justify it. I know exactly who I am, and I don't give a fuck if a random stranger I've just met thinks I'm gay or straight, because I'm confident in it and I don't need your approval. That's actually more likely to get them to change their mind than a well-executed argument.
Like, so, or even pointing out like the inappropriateness of the question, be like, I'm sorry, one, it's like you don't have to tear open your journal to prove a thing, but also just like make them. I love making someone feel silly because they think like, well, this person is a different type of person, so I can ask them this inappropriate question.
Yeah.
Like, no, it's still an inappropriate question. Yeah. Right. And it's like, and then all of a sudden it's like, oh fuck, did I fuck up? Now am I an asshole for asking? And
answer is like, yeah, a little bit. But yeah, so I think when I was younger, I felt more compelled to really stand up for the brand and everything. And as you get older, you're like, hey, you need to protect your mental health and awareness. Yeah. And you can't get into an argument with every single person.
And well, now you can also just be like, or you can buy my book.
Buy my book. Oh, that's what I'm going to say. Here's a list. Yeah. That's your answer. Hey, I actually address all of this in my book. I would love for you to read it.
Yeah.
But yeah, keep it short, keep it confident, and you'll be good.
And on the similar thing about, you know, the sluttiness, which again, it's been touched on, our prolific question asker, Chuck, he asks, do you ever get pushback over the term boy slut because of the promiscuous stereotype that's out there with the negative connotation it sometimes has?
May I hold on? Can you hold my mic for
a sec?
Please.
Get in the book. It's called Boy Slut. I don't know if y'all know. There'll be a link in the show notes, but Boy Slut, it's out May 9th.
So I actually have a glossary at the beginning of the book, and that's just because there are a lot of terms in this book that I didn't want to kind of derail the conversation. You know, when I'm talking about demisexuals or phrasexuals or like polycules and metamors, and it's just like a lot of language that when I'm trying to write a fucking story and then I have to break down what everything means, it's kind of annoying. And then also there are actually different definitions of bisexuality and pansexuality. And I wanted to make sure that, hey, when I'm using this word, here's what I mean by it. So we're on the same page.
It's also great to do in anytime somebody wants to like have that, like a debate. I'm always just like, can we like, what does the drag show mean to you? Just so I know what we mean when we say a word.
Yeah.
And then we can move forward with yelling at each other on Twitter.
Exactly. And it's funny because I kind of did this. I don't want to say willy nilly. I just did it because I thought it was important. And the feedback, people are like, I love your glossary. Like, it's really helped me understand these complex terms and seeing more nuance in it. In a way, it's also cool to be able to define things for myself. You know what I mean? Of course, and I quote other people and use stuff. I'm not pulling shit out of thin air. But anyway, I define the word boy slut in the glossary because I felt that was important. And this is going to be a good practice because I haven't been reading these out loud. I'm going to have to for my book tour. Boy slut. You might not be thrilled by the title of this book or by the fact that I call myself and readers boy sluts. After all, the word slut is highly gendered, and it has seldom been hurled at me, parentheses n, so me or men, as an insult intended to harm, belittle, or control my behavior. Men are often praised for having sex with a lot of women. They're called a player or a regular Don Juan, whereas women are deemed simply sluts. This pervasive double standard is not new, and men have always benefited from it. I know I have. Unfairly, women who are called sluts are often deemed either mentally unwell, she's got real daddy issues, or undeserving of love. I'd never marry a slut. So why do I feel like it's my right to reclaim a word that hasn't typically been used to hurt and control me? First, I choose to identify as a boy slut because it exposes the double standard of promiscuity associated with men and women, and in doing so, hopefully works to dismantle it. Second, as someone who also proudly identifies as a queer faggot, I know the power of reclamation. I hope to help remove some of the stigma and shame that accompanies being a boy or boy slut. So what exactly is a boy slut? Again, this is great practice. Thank you. Almost done here. Don't worry.
It's okay. I'm not worried.
I define it as a person of any gender or sexual orientation who approaches sex without a lick of judgment or shame. Being a boy slut is not about having a high body count. It's about having the sex you want, with whomever you want, however you want, without shame. Identifying as a boy slut is to give a gigantic middle finger to society, letting everyone on this planet know that you will not be controlled or behave a certain way just because that's what's considered normal, ethical, or right. Nailed it. All right, I'll be okay at my readings.
Everyone snap, everyone snap.
Thank you, thank you. How have you dealt with this? You have whore in the name.
Well, you know, it's pretty interesting you bring up the whole, like, how could I reclaim something that wasn't used to harm me?
Yeah.
So you have slut in yours, I have whore in mine. And, well, it's like, I think my personal pushback, because my story is that I wanted love and dating relationships. You know, this show started because women would sleep with me, they wouldn't date me, right? And I was like, someone cuddle and all that jazz. Despite our previous thing was like, cuddling's a resource I must guard behind a safe. Yeah. It's Inception, you must penetrate now. No, it's So sometimes women, because I like did a lot of fun slutty things, it wasn't even like about like body count stuff. It was, I did this fun Craigslist thing. I did go to a gangbang. And so sometimes like, oh my God, you're such a man whore. And I sometimes started to feel like maybe they were using that to like dismiss my potential to be a boyfriend. And so
I
it was a word that was used that made me feel like maybe I'm too slutty to love or be loved. And so I'm going to go with the man whore podcast. And I have gotten pushback from like sex worker people. But I think it's a lot of times because they don't know that part. Mm-hmm. And once that's explained, most people are on board. And then some are still like, but you're not a whore. And then like I've been paid for various sexual things. So it's like, and now a lot of people go, I guess he's okay. I guess he's allowed in. He's begrudgingly, he's a whore. Come on in, buddy. Here's your key.
I think I've had a similar, actually quite a similar, experience where I've definitely received some pushback from people. Well, but that's the reason why I defined it, right? Because to be like, hey, is this my right? Is it okay that I'm doing this? And I hope to, you might disagree with me, but at least I kind of provide a little bit more explanation and to show that there was some thought that went into this. This wasn't something willy-nilly, and I'm aware of the double standard and the way the word slut has been used traditionally. Mm-hmm.
Because we love ownership, we love a little self-awareness.
It's also, I get away with it more than you do because I'm queer, and I feel like, you know, gay men call each other sluts and that's kind of fine,
but it's like, for me, like, women were the ones calling me a slut and calling me a man whore. Like, I didn't go around and be like, I'm such a man whore. Everyone's like, nah, he's such a man whore, I'm never gonna date him. But like, come back, no, come over, do that thing with your tongue. I like,
and like, actually, you know what, it's catchy. It's like you can see the cover of this book.
Yeah.
It shimmers. It glistens. It's got a little tinfoil gloss. Yeah. You know, like, I think people are going to pick it up. I think if you see this in a bookstore and you see that, you're not going to be like, oh, let me walk by it. You're like, what is going on here? People will stop and they'll be like,
what's this about?
Yeah.
I think, no, that's definitely, it stands out. No, I definitely agree. Love the fucking title. I just didn't know, like, I didn't even know if you got pushback. So thought ask.
Yeah.
Or Chuck thought he'd ask.
Thank you, Chuck.
Vince, you're a big fanboy, already pre-ordered the book. It's called Boy Slut, by the way.
If I don't know if you guys know.
I just want to make sure.
Yeah, just in case.
So, link in the show notes, May 9th. Okay, so he also wanted to know, this might put you on the spot a little bit, but do you have maybe, like, a couple of hookup stories that I'll rephrase this. How's this to make it easier for you? Do you have any hookup stories that went hilariously wrong? Maybe one with a gal and one with a guy.
I mean,
I mean, I know. Okay, without poop, how's that one? Because I know that's
frequent. Of course, why I went to.
And there's a frequent one.
There was just one where it was this guy. I was maybe like 26, and he was maybe 23, and he was recently out and like barely spoke English, and I speak my broken Spanish. But we got along. We met on a hookup app. And you can just tell he was very nervous about it. And I learned he wasn't out to his family, really out to his friends. And there was one time where, like, you know, he was riding me and he still had, like, douche water in. So then he pulled out and then it was just, like, just a ton, like a bucket's worth of just kind of brown water. And he started crying. And I was like, this guy who's trying. And I'm like, honey, it's okay. I'm just going to go shower. It's just on my stomach. I'm going to do it. Don't worry. And I literally, I'm probably the perfect person to shit on, metaphorically and literally.
Accidentally.
Please.
Perfect to accidentally shit on.
I have many kinks. Scat is not one of them. But give me 20 years. I feel like I'll be out of the rest of them and be like, well, here we are. Let's do this. But like, I showered and like by the time he was already like clothed and back, I'm like, honey, it's okay. I gave him a hug. Like, I was so supportive. And he ghosted me. He felt so bad, and I knew it had nothing to do with me. Like, yeah. I know that, but I was like, hey, I'd love to see you again, and it just, I felt so sad for him, because fuck, like, shit happens, literally, you know what I mean? Like, so that was just, like, a kind of an unfortunate thing, and his ass was amazing, so I'm really sad, just for, on a personal note, that I was able to mourn the loss for me, personally, but that was interesting. It's been interesting where, again, I am a D-minus list celebrity. A D-minus list gay celebrity, which means not a celebrity in the real world at all by any
in
stretch
New
of the imagination.
In New York City and LA, I am a total celebrity in queer culture.
It's like, it's innate, like people... with my girlfriend now, she like was at Hacienda and she was like, people like, you're dating the Zachary Zane. And I'm like, I'm known among bisexual, polyamorous, sex positive people who live in Brooklyn. This is the one sphere of the world in which there's an ounce
very relatable
of celebrity. But like, I'm like, let me explain that I am not by any metric otherwise. But I've had people, women who like, specifically sleep with me because they've read my stories, because they've want to get the boy slut experience. Oh my god, I want to puke just saying that out loud. It's just like, it's interesting. And then like afterwards, the like, I don't want to say, it's not that she critiqued me, but she was definitely just like, oh, I like, so that's what's like sleeping with the boy. And I mind you, I had no idea. I guess
that's what it's like.
Yeah, sleeping with like Zach, I did not talk about my book. I did not talk about work. They had no I did not know.
Sorry,
that
wait. What's your book called?
A Boy Slut, okay. Memoir Manifesto, out May 9th. And it's but like they did. I didn't talk about it. They didn't.
Yeah.
Talk about. It. So I had no idea that they kind of knew me or had been reading my shit, and that was like left me feeling like fine. You're like. You're allowed to not bring it up, but then also to not bring it up, but then after sex, then like judge me based off of this and then bring it up at that point.
Wait, so was the judgment negative?
The judgment was more
meh.
Meh. Ugh. Yeah, I think it was more meh being like, oh, so that's what's like sleeping with the boy slut. I was like, what?
I didn't know we got the same feedback after sex. Zach.
I know, every time. No, but it's just like, yeah. So that was just kind of like, huh. Okay.
Did you get, were you self-conscious? Did you like ask follow-up questions or?
I don't, it was fine. It was slightly above average sex with someone who had hooked up at a party. Nothing was super exciting. Like, no, like it wasn't. Yeah.
Your ego doesn't
I thought it was slightly above average. You know what? I thought it was meh too. Not everything's going to be a home run. And
You didn't respond with like, I guess that's what it's like to sleep with Tiffany.
I don't care. You know what I mean? Like, let her think what she wants to think. And it was, yeah, a finely mediocre experience on both of our behalves, just because whatever. Not everything's going to be a home run. Maybe I wasn't as attracted to her as maybe I wanted. Who the fuck knows? Okay. You know what I mean? They could be one of 10 million things. And I'm not judging myself because I didn't have incredible sex with a stranger who then is now judging me on a scale I didn't know existed.
Yeah, just keep it in front.
Sorry, am I bad?
No, you're all right. You're all right. You were like a little over here.
Yeah.
I get nervous now if I hook up with like a listener. It's just like I have actually hooked up with listeners and then they stop listening afterwards because I guess it wasn't good enough sex.
Oh no!
Or I was a dick. I hold space for that too. So like I've definitely like lost like Patreon members like shortly after hooking up.
I don't think it's you're bad at sex. I think it's the.
Illusion?
It's the mystery. It's the appeal. It's the illusion. Like, people.
That mystery is apparently worth $5 a month.
Yeah, yes, it is. And like, there definitely, I feel like certain people where now they're gonna think. And again, I like, how do I say this without sounding like an asshole? Like, I'm pretty good at sex. That is my job. I am a sex columnist and writer. I'm communicative. I'm honest. I know the technique. I can kind of read social cues, see if they're feeling uncomfortable. If so, slow things down, ask how things are going. I create a space where like they're allowed to embrace their kinks and say whatever the fuck they want. And so because I've created the space and I know the technique and skills, like I'm able to usually have a pretty good sexual experience with people. But sometimes people just like assume like I like have a 15-inch cock and can pound for 5,000 days or like just I've now put you on a pedestal.
I mean, I have seen it. It's not. It's closer to 15 than like not.
It's
I've seen you walk around soft, man.
That is fake news. That is fake news and quite generous, and I appreciate it. But yeah, it's just. But people get really excited by the idea of you and the fantasy of you, and
more often than not, you can never live up to a fantasy.
Well, once we all lose the blue check marks, I think that will go down a little bit.
So oh, God. I've been trying to get off Twitter anyhow now, just because it's not great for my mental health. And I feel like a piece of shit after scrolling.
I can't, because it's like the most that I got. I have to be there.
But now this is giving me a nice excuse to be like, well, you know, the blue check is gone. I'm fucking done with this shit anyway.
Sure.
Luckily, I'm verified on Instagram, so I still have that blue check. So as long as you got one, no, I'm just joking. Now I'm a true asshole.
I got one more Ask the Guest question. But then would you mind, because I don't think we've done this before, maybe a little 10 minutes bonus episode about like just some tips on picking up men at a bar. You know, maybe like two or three tips we could do that.
Picking up men at a bar.
After I ask you this like quick one, you think that?
Sure.
Okay, cool. So real quick, Chuck does want to know, I think this is a fitting one to end on before we do plugs, is he just wants to know, what's your number?
Oh, God. You know, when I wrote the book, I said over 2,000 people. And now that book, I think that section was over a year ago. I have no idea whether it's 3,500, 1,500, or 2,500. But I think anywhere, I would assume in the two to 3,000 range would be my guess.
And here I thought it started with 818. But yeah. Zachary, this was great. Patreon people, tune in tomorrow for a little bonus. But I keep forgetting. What's the name of the book that's coming out?
Boy Slut. BOYSLUT, : a memoir and manifesto. And yeah, it's when is this podcast out? May 9th?
Very soon.
Very soon. Yeah. Okay, so it's available for pre-order.
I'll have a link in the show notes to it, regardless when it's out. So you can either pre-order or order it, depending when it's out.
Pre-order sales help me so fucking much. Pre-order sales in the first week sales. So like, please buy anywhere between... If you could buy as many books as people I've slept with, I would be a New York Times bestseller extremely quickly. So if you could help me with that, I'd really, really appreciate it.
And where do you want people following you these days?
Sure. I mean, again, I'm still on Twitter and Instagram. That's ZacharyZane_. The underscore's at the end. My website, ZacharyZane.com. You can ask me questions through that. I also have this like nonfiction erotica zine, which is different from the book. It's like my newsletter. It's like the newsletter. And that's also Boy Slut. And that's just
no wonder Julie's a fucking fan of it.
That shit is just raunchy ass sex stories of like real sex stories that happened to me and other people. I have a collection of like writers across the globe. So if you Google Boy Slut Substack or just Boy Slut, it will come up that. And yeah, that's it.
Fantastic. Well, you know, why don't you go ahead and say goodbye to everybody?
Oh, did we want to do the three questions?
We are, yeah. It's just like, it'll be a bonus thing. Gotcha. I'll just like reintro it real quick.
Gotcha. Well, everyone, thank you so much for listening. And Billy, this was a ton of fun. This was awesome.
As always, man. As always. That Patreon exclusive bonus episode is coming out. It's dropping. It's releasing tomorrow. That'll be available for all of the $5 and up Patreon members. And it's just one bonus episode of nearly 300 bonus episodes. If you're a binger, if you're one of those freaks who have heard everything I've said, did you know that there's even more on the Patreon? Oh yeah. Easily another 100 to 200 hours of sex positive audio content back there available for just $5 a month. Pay for the whole year up front, you get a discount. What a guy I am. As always, links to the Patreon and everything else you could need exist in the notes of this show, sometimes referred to as the show notes. Now, as many of you know, the Champagne Room is our super free, super fun, super sex positive Discord server. And we have a lot of channels about a lot of things. For example, the best place to share your thoughts and questions and comments about this week's episode with Zachary Zane is in the episode discussion channel in the Champagne Room. But we've got channels about books, about arts and crafts, about cannabis, about parenting, about pets. There's an entire channel called I Just Had Sex where if you get laid, I mean, we are very excited to read about it. And so I'm going to share a real funny, embarrassing sex story someone shared. It's embarrassing because I asked for embarrassing sex stories. I am not calling it an embarrassing sex story. I read Jeff's last week. This week, we're going to hear Steph's as we close out. But if you want to join us in the Champagne Room, the link's in the show notes, or you can go to manwhorepod.com/discord. And now, an embarrassing sex story from Steph. I was having sex with this guy at his place while his roommates were supposed to be in class. We're going at it, and he asks if he can pull out, take off the condom, and come on me. I say go for it, so he's going for it, and I feel something graze my cheek. Maybe it was like the sheet, maybe it was the pillow cushion. So out of reflex, I lifted my head to figure out what it was. Just as the round, and by round, she does not mean a bullet. I mean, she means ropes of jizz. Just as the round goes shooting out, it hits me right in the face, getting into my left eye. I yell in surprise. He's still going, because you can't really control the dick too much. Once it starts spurting people, it is spurting. But she says, I yell in surprise. He's still going, but he's like, oh shit, are you okay? Which is a hilarious image. He's just like jizzing and jizzing, but going, oh no, I can't stop. Are you okay? At this point, I've tried to wipe it off and only succeeded in getting it in my eye. So now I'm yelling variations of fuck and it hurts. Keep in mind, this is the middle of the day. We are completely naked. Sunlight is coming in and lights are on. The next thing I know, some guy comes flying into the room asking what's going on. I start yelling again because, like, hello, I'm naked. And who is this random asshole? And don't forget, everyone, she's got cum in her eye. My hookup is also naked and he tackles said asshole and shoved him out the door and then turns to me and is like, are you okay? I take it he's no longer jizzing at this point when he asks. Are you okay? I've got one eye shut. I'm covered in cum and thoroughly embarrassed. Now, I just stared at him like, are you shitting me? My only lucky break in all this is his room had the ensuite bathroom, so he had to help me into the shower. I go ahead and just wash everything because it got in my hair too. I finally finish showering. I turn around to get out. He's just standing there watching me and tells me, so my roommates are home early. Yeah, no shit. I get dressed, grab my stuff, and I'm like, please let these dudes be in their rooms. We walk out and nope, they're both waiting in the kitchen, which was right across from my guy's bedroom door. My hair is obviously wet from the shower, and they clearly heard us at the very end of the sex, at minimum. They're both hiding smiles, and this idiot I just let cover me and come is like, hey, this is Steph. We were just studying. We all turned to look at him at the same time. I just couldn't take it anymore. I turned and walked out. We made sure no one was getting out of class early after that. Thank you for sharing your embarrassing cum-covered sex story, Steph. Everybody else, stay slutty.
I'm Richard Serrett. Join me on Strange Planet for in-depth conversations with the world's top paranormal investigators, alien abductees, Bigfoot trackers, monster hunters, time travelers, and more.
The handler one day told her this whole thing about how they've been terraforming on Mars and they're building a colony and they're recruiting specific people of specific bloodlines and specific talents and skill sets to go onto the planet.
On Richard Serrett's Strange Planet, we're redefining reality. Listen now wherever you get your podcasts.